Good day and welcome to the webinar, When Requirements Change, Continuing to Meet User Expectations with Requirements Traceability. I'm Peter Varhol, Solutions Evangelist at Seapine Software, and what we're going to do over the next hour is I'm going to talk about for about 40 minutes on requirements traceability and what you do when requirements change and how you can reflect those changes throughout the application development lifecycle process. And then what I'm going to give about a 5-minute demonstration on some of the ways of doing so. I'm going to open it up for questions afterwards. We're not going to take questions over the voiceover IP. Instead, I'd like you to type your questions into the question and answer, the Q&A panel on your WebEx console, and I'll get to as many of those as I can through the top of the hour. I have an agenda. I'd like to talk to you first of all about what is requirements traceability. Why do we care about traceability? Why should it be important to us in the application development lifecycle? Next, what happens when requirements change? Why does traceability come into play, and what can we do about traceability when we have requirements that change through the application development lifecycle? Talk a little bit about approaches to traceability, and then I'll summarize, and then we'll take questions, and that will probably take about 40 or 45 minutes. So first of all, what is requirements traceability? It's really the process of starting with a software requirement, or really a business requirement, and correlating it with artifacts downstream. We'd like the ability to take that business requirement and follow the life cycle of that business requirement from its conception to the deployment of the software that satisfies that requirement. In doing so, we'd like to document the relationship between the requirement and those artifacts, as well as document, in general, the transformation of that business requirement into the design of software, the development software, and the testing of software through those artifacts. What do I mean, first of all, by artifacts? And I'll say a little bit about that first, and then I also want to say a little bit more about traceability before we go on. An artifact is anything that is produced during the application development lifecycle as a result of that business requirement. It could be a specification, one or more specifications actually, source code, test plans, test cases, defects, and anything that is a part of the process that we can point to and say, we can trace this back in some way, shape, or form to the requirement. Now, the other point that I wanted to make before we moved on is this sounds like an awful lot of work, and you may be doing this now, and you may or may not have decided it's an awful lot of work to take a business requirement and trace it all the way through to the deployment of a software application that satisfies that requirement. But one of the things that I'd like to stress here over the next 45 minutes or so is that in doing so, it doesn't have to be a lot of work. You can put automation to use, first of all, to be able to help you trace a requirement through to the specifications, the source code, the test plans, test cases, the defects, all the way through the deployment of the application. And it's very little, if any, additional work over what you're doing today. The second thing that I'd like to stress is that by applying automation and by doing that, you probably don't have to do a whole lot more, if anything, than you're already doing. Yet the value of it, you're going to see the value of it, especially over a longer application development life cycle where requirements, in fact, business requirements, do change. So why is this important? Let's step back and look about why we care about traceability, what helps us determine the quality of our application. In terms of what I mean by the quality of the application is it helps us understand that product in terms of its intended use in the business or by our customers. It helps us determine the fitness for use of that product. Have we actually produced something that the business needs? It also helps us learn from our mistakes. At the end of the project, we can go back and isolate requirements that saw the most issues and or testing effort and or source code changes, defects, whatever they may be, and evaluate why those particular areas based on that requirement were such a problem. So it enables us to understand our quality and understand our product better, manage and communicate inevitable changes over the application development lifecycle, and at the end, it enables us to better look back and learn from our mistakes. So once again, why is it important? And I'd really like to emphasize the fact that it makes sure that we're delivering the product that has actually been defined by the requirements. Oftentimes, we can lose sight of the original business requirements in the day-to-day work of software development and software test, especially in a longer software development cycle. So traceability enables us to always go back to those business requirements and say, here is the problem that we're trying to solve. More, just as important, it provides an audit trail for accountability. Once again, we can learn from our mistakes. We can also identify where information may be lost in the process, where we may be losing the fact that a requirement has changed or whether or not it's changed. We may, in fact, be able to point to some source code, some specification language, some test cases, and say, this doesn't really reflect what we're trying to accomplish in this business requirement. We've had a loss of information from one step in the application development lifecycle to the next. We've lost information from the definition and approval of those requirements to the design specification or to the test cases. This is important in any application development project. However, it's particularly important where you're attempting to satisfy requirements that may not be functional requirements, but may in fact be regulatory requirements. If you're in an industry that is governed by regulatory requirements concerning the production and use of software, whether that be finance, safety critical applications, certain manufacturing operations and things like that, you probably all know all about the regulatory requirements in the environment in which you work. Traceability in many, many cases helps you satisfy those regulatory requirements. So how about when applications change? What do we do about changing requirements? Especially during a lengthy development effort, I've been involved in development efforts that go on for a year or 18 months or even longer. Even when you have shorter development cycles, you may have, if you've got a rapidly changing business or if you've got rapidly changing business conditions, you could have requirements changing. In fact, it's probably normal for requirements to change. How, in fact, can traceability help us make sure that the changes to those business requirements become a part of the final project? Now, once again, what we've oftentimes done when we're at this point is we've defined and we have approved requirements. We have produced specifications. We have approved specifications. We have a test plan, an approved test plan. We have test cases that are generated from that test plan and are likely mapped back to individual requirements. And we have coding beginning. And we may or may not have substantial amounts of code produced at this point in time. So let's say business requirement changes, one or more business requirement changes. How do we make sure that that change, one or more changes to the business requirements, get reflected downstream in change specifications, change test cases, change source code, and make sure that any defects that we've recorded already are no longer are still valid in an era where a business requirement may in fact have changed. So that seems to make sense when you have a lengthy development cycle. How about agile? How about if you go agile, do you still care about traceability? And I'd say that the answer to that is most definitely, because you're not only reflecting changes, but you're also reflecting going back and forth with the user, the project owner, and the user community with regards to, is this software correct the way it is? Does this software need to change? Do we need to rethink our user stories in light of what we've actually produced, and so on? So traceability is still important, not only when you have lengthy development cycles, but also when you have shorter development cycles in an agile type environment. In fact, you want to allow for changes when you have that agile development process, and you want to make those changes as seamless as possible. You also need to be concerned about these changes because you care what happens to our schedule. Does the change blow up the schedule? Are we able to incorporate changes to the business requirements as a result of, in terms of the existing schedule, or do we need to expand that schedule based on these changes? Once again, we need to go back. Are we going to put the team through longer hours to try to maintain that schedule? Is that schedule very, very important to meet the existing schedule? Or can we expand that schedule? Traceability helps us identify any changes to the schedule and helps us answer those questions too. As I've already mentioned, changes that we have, once we change a requirement, these artifacts downstream have to change to reflect those changes to the business requirement. What are those artifacts? Once again, they're anything that we produce during the application development lifecycle as a part of those requirements. They could include functional descriptions, design specifications, test plans and test cases, actual source code, and the acceptance criteria for the application. If we don't know what downstream artifacts or requirement refers to, we can't really ensure that the changes to that requirement have, or requirements for that matter, have been reflected in the completed product. We need to be able to say, once we've changed that requirement, we've in fact changed functional descriptions, specifications, test cases, code, and our acceptance criteria to make sure that, once again, the product that we're delivering is the product that our end users need for the business. Traceability is especially important under conditions when requirements start changing. If we can't trace the changes to requirements through to the acceptance criteria and the deployed product, we can't be sure that the right product has in fact been built. When we look about traceability and change, we recognize that changes have to trace both forwards and backwards. It's pretty apparent why we have to go ahead and trace forward, that is, from the business requirement to the functional description to the design specification to the test plan and test cases to AMP to source code to the issues into the acceptance criteria and so on. But we also have to trace from the final acceptance back to those original requirements. Well, why do we have to do that? Why do we have to trace backwards from that final product, from the acceptance criteria, all the way back to those requirements? And the reason is simply that helps ensure that the evolving product, because remember, the requirements aren't the only thing that are changing here. Oftentimes, the product itself, we already have source code, we may be running test cases, and so on. That revolving product remains on the right track with regards to requirements. We need to be able to say, These test cases actually reflect the current state of requirements, so we're actually testing the product as the product is currently required. Tracing changes in requirements is especially difficult because these artifacts often reside in isolated silos. They have their different applications. I have a friend who is involved, she's a technical writer with a ongoing software development project, and they use open source tools for requirements. In fact, they use Microsoft Word for requirements gathering, so their business requirements are encapsulated in a word processing document. Their source code is in CVS, their defects are in Bugzilla, and so on down the list. So there's no easy way to offer communications between the various products that they're using to control the business requirements and the various artifacts that they're producing as a result of the software development process. So as I say here, your design, your business requirements could be in a word processing document or in requirements management software, however you might do it. Your design may be in words, or it may be in a combination of words or diagrams, or you may be using the Unified Modeling Language, or UML, as a way to express your design. You may have test management software. You may be managing tests manually, but either way, they don't necessarily approach you using to manage your test cases. Doesn't necessarily integrate very well, if at all, with the word processing document or your UML software. In addition, you have separate source code control software. So your source code is in an entirely different repository. Your defect tracking software is, once again, in an entirely different repository. And as a result, you may have five or six different repositories and five or six different ways of getting access to the same artifacts that map back to that original business requirement. So the question is, this is why people tend to think that requirements traceability is such a long and involved and difficult process, because the requirements reside in one location and all of the artifacts that relate to those requirements reside in their own applications, or we have our own repositories, or we're managing them manually as a part of this. So there's no way of tracing the requirements through to these artifacts. There's no easy way. We oftentimes have to do it manually. We may be drawing very, very complex diagrams, or we may be trying to put together something that doesn't necessarily reflect in an entirely separate package, that doesn't necessarily reflect what is the current state of affairs in our requirements or those related artifacts. And that can be a really, really big problem, and that's why traceability seems like it's a really, really big problem. I'd like to say that if we can automate and have some level of integration between the various repositories, that between the requirements and the artifacts that we're producing as a result of those requirements, that it can actually be a very natural part of our software development process to do traceability. So really there's three ways of approaching traceability. You can do it manually. I refer to that as a poor solution here. That's a lot of work. You can have a programmatic interface between the different repositories, different tools you have, a programmatic interface such as the Simple Object Access Protocol or SOAP or some sort of web-based interface or other communications mechanism between these tools, and pass data back and forth using a custom interface. Or you can have an integrated solution where most or all of the traceability information, most of all the repositories and the links between those repositories are automatically available, starting from your requirements through the test cases, the defects, the source code, and so on. I'd like to say that the interface between the tools, where we have a programmatic interface and can develop a programmatic solution passing data back and forth, that's a better solution. But our best solution is really the integrated approach to traceability, where we can do that sort of thing automatically as a manual part, as a natural part, I should say, of our software application development lifecycle process. So how do we approach traceability, especially from the standpoint of changing requirements? So first of all, let's just acknowledge that traceability flows out from our requirements. We should have requirements referenced in test cases, functional descriptions, specifications, source code, and defects. When the requirements change, this should be a documented process, so we have a mechanism for changing requirements. It would be ideal if changes to requirements would automatically flow into the artifacts. That's a little bit unrealistic, at least with our current state of technology. At best, or at worst, what we should have today is an acknowledgement that when we change requirements, that should set up flags to precisely what's going to change in our specifications, in our functional descriptions, in our source code, in our test cases, and in our defects. These changes, as we do them, should be formally requested and documented. We should know, we should be able to have documentation and a method of communicating what requirements change, what the change is, and we should be able to also know specifically what has changed and why it's changed. Oftentimes, organizations use change requests and change orders as a beginning part of that process, rather than just going ahead and changing. It seems like it's some additional work, but really what it is, it's a communications mechanism. It's a way of letting the entire team know that something has changed at the business requirement level that's going to possibly affect you. It would be ideal if we can point to the very specific things, the very specific test cases, defects, specification, source code, and so on, that is going to change. But at least we need to know that, at the very least, we need to know that there is a change that is going to affect us. And that's what I'm saying here on this slide also. Ideally, the change orders can identify, or the requirements that our automation can identify, the downstream artifacts. We need that communications mechanism. We need to know what has changed. If we can't identify the downstream artifacts that have changed, it falls upon the team to have traceability defined, or to manually go ahead and trace so that these artifacts can be called up and examined. We may have an artifact tree or a matrix that enables us to readily identify this particular relationship between our requirements and the downstream artifacts. I have an example of a tree here in the diagram here, and I'm going to go into a little bit more detail in the traceability matrix a little bit later. So here within the concept of the traceability matrix, we're able to correlate requirements with our development and our testing artifacts. We can visualize the relationship between our business requirements and the other artifacts in development and in test, and in communicating to the team members what in fact has changed. The relationship should also be a part of each document, but the business requirements, we ought to be able to see the relationships there. We ought to be able to see the relationships in our test plans and test cases, and we ought to be able to see it in our source code. But the matrix itself provides a means of visualizing or picturing those relationships. The traceability matrix, in addition, provides us the ability to validate that requirement requirements, as long as we're able to look at this, it enables us to validate that the requirements are being met, even as those requirements are in fact being changed. So this is just an example of a traceability matrix, and I'm actually going to produce this same traceability matrix in just a few minutes here. But it enables us to create the relationships between requirements and other artifacts. In this case, I have enable the team to visualize the relationship between functional requirements and test cases. So we're able to look at the requirements and which test cases do in fact relate to those requirements. So for example, you can look in the first column here, and you can see that there's a requirement, it's labeled as a functional requirement in the column, that is related to, that links back up to a specific test case, which is the row across the top there. So the requirement links directly to the test case. You also notice that it's flagged. I'll talk a little bit about what that flag means within the context of Seapine Test Track Pro in just a couple minutes here. So one thing I'd like to emphasize again, I mentioned it at the beginning of this talk here, and I kind of like to emphasize again, this is not rocket science. It's not complex. It doesn't have to be complex, I should say. It shouldn't be difficult to maintain. In fact, traceability, in fact, that's the biggest complaint that I've heard about traceability over the years, is that it's a high maintenance process. I have to put a lot of time and effort in ensuring that when I have a business requirement, I maintain those links from business requirement to the various downstream artifacts. Well, it shouldn't be a high maintenance process. It should, in fact, be a natural part of the software development process, whether you're using a waterfall approach to software development, whether you have lengthy development cycles, whether you're using an agile approach to software development and have shorter development cycles and getting a lot of feedback through the software development process, if you're iterating through software. However you may do it, traceability shouldn't be a high maintenance process. It should be an almost automatic part of what you're doing as part of the software development process. And I believe that automation enables that, or the right kind of automation enables that to happen. So I'd like to spend the next few minutes talking about steps that you can use to establish and maintain traceability from your requirements to software development projects, from your requirements to the artifacts, the downstream artifacts in the software development process, including, once again, functional descriptions, detailed specifications, source code, test plans, test cases, and defects that are generated as a result of the application of those test cases to the source code. So, and in particular, when those requirements change, how can you maintain traceability, and how can you ensure that traceability enables you, when you have changes in business requirements, how traceability can enable you to work through those changes from the downstream artifacts that need to change in order to ensure that you're producing the software that what you end up with actually satisfies those changed business requirements. First of all, as artifacts begin to be developed, you have your approved business requirement and you start developing functional descriptions, specifications, writing source code, developing test cases and things like that. You need to be able to link those requirements both forwards and backwards between the business requirements and those artifacts. And you need to do so in an automated way. Drawing diagrams is great as long as your requirements never change, as long as things never change, because you're able to refer to those diagrams that you've drawn lines between the requirements and the various artifacts. Once things start changing, either if you go back to the opening slide in this presentation, you need a pencil with a very, very good eraser, or you need to put an awful lot of time into maintaining your traceability. We don't want to do any of that. At least I don't. I would prefer having that done for me. An automated integrated solution will handle those links for you. Use some formal mechanism. I cringe at the word formal because that implies that it's a heavyweight process. It doesn't have to be. Use change requests or change orders. These can be as simple as emails, something you can trace back to and say, here's why this business requirement has changed. Whether it be an email, whether it be a piece of paper, whether it be an item in a spreadsheet, whatever it might be, have something that is documented. It's not documentation for the sake of documentation. It's documentation for the sake of communications with the team members, because it's important that those upfront changes that you have be communicated so that team members can identify and change the downstream artifacts that are getting changed also. You want to change the requirements first and then look at the downstream artifacts that need to be changed. Ideally, changes to requirements will automatically flag those downstream artifacts that need to be changed. Ideally, you can actually go ahead and make the change. I don't think we're there yet in the state of technology, but at the very least, we've got to be able to flag those downstream artifacts and say, guess what, your business requirement has changed. You need to, once again, take a look at this test case. You can use traceability to identify those changes. It would be great if traceability could actually make those changes, but I just don't think we're there yet. And work with the artifact owners once you've gone ahead and changed the business requirement, identified artifacts that need to change. Work with the artifact owners to make sure that those changes are reflected in their test cases, source code, acceptance criteria, whatever it might be. An example I have here is a change requirement points to and means a change test case. Initiate the change, look at the required artifacts, and decide how downstream artifacts have to change. Make sure the requirements and artifacts are documented appropriately, and I should say changed requirements and artifacts are documented appropriately. We need to know that these changes have been made and what the original was, in fact, in case we need to go back and say, oops, we've dropped the ball here. And here's why we dropped the ball. We didn't pick up this particular change. So we need to make sure that we have some level of change control on both the requirements and the artifact so we can go back and say, well, this was the original requirement, this was the original artifact. Once we've changed the requirement, we changed the downstream artifact in such a way to reflect that. And that's because team members who have developed these artifacts, example test cases, need to know that they've changed, what the changes are, and they need to be able to say to themselves, and this changed because why? And that requires them to go back to the original business requirement and say, oh, I see, this requirement has changed in such a way, therefore this my test case has had to change also. Use a traceability matrix or a tree for being able to visualize the relationship between your business requirements and those artifacts. Ideally, you're generating this through automation. You can, once again, you can draw these pictures, and it doesn't seem like a lot of work. At least it doesn't seem like a lot of work until those requirements start changing. And that's why when requirements change, it's important to be able to reflect the changing relationships. So with that in mind, I'd like to, if I can use the WebEx console appropriately, I'd like to just show you for 4 or 5 minutes how we might go ahead and accomplish this with Seapine Test Track Pro. So I've got a requirements document here in Test Track Pro. You see the requirements document is well organized. This is Test Track Requirements Management, which is a part of Test Track Pro, and you see that I have selected a specific requirement. Well, if I wanted to establish a link with that requirement, I can simply go ahead and right-click, bring up a menu, and add a link. And I can actually select that link. I can make it a parent so that as I link it to other items, I'm not going to do it here because in the interest of time, I already have traceability matrix already created, so I'm not going to go ahead and create another link. But I can very easily create a link here between this requirement and some downstream artifacts such as a test case, even source code and defects and things like that. So once I've done that, I can come up here and I've actually already created, if I want to create a traceability matrix, I can come up here to the activities menu and select traceability matrix and go ahead and create it. They're very easy to create, and I've already have one created here, so I'm just going to bring up the one that I have created. And what I've done is I've created rows that contain functional requirements. So you can see that here. I've created columns that reflect my test cases. And I've gone ahead and, well, I should go ahead and update this matrix here. I'm not going to filter this here, but I should go ahead and update that. And you can see, for example, I've got functional requirement 25 that is directly related to, is apparent and is related to, as you can see, I've got a link here that says I've got a row to column link or a requirement to test case link here that is linked to test case 7. Notice that I've also got that flagged. Well, you're probably asking yourself at this point, what does that flag mean? The flag means that this has been flagged as suspect, which means that something has changed here, that my requirement has changed, and this requirement, because it's been linked to this particular test case, is already telling me that this test case may require change. It doesn't mean it will require change. It means that it may require change based on change to the requirement. It's suspect. So let's go ahead and drill into this and see just what that might be here. And we can go ahead and say we've got test case 7, we've got a suspect requirement, and this was changed, actually it looks like it was changed about a year and a half ago. So, but I can go ahead and drill into this some more. And I can see some detail here. I can see the workflow. I can look at what the detail might be here. And I can look at the requirement and also look at the test case. So I can see actually how this requirement relates to this test case and what might have to change as a result of that. So with that in mind, I'm going to go back here to our presentation. I'm going to stop sharing, and I think that you should be able to see the presentation again here. So what I wanted to show there really was that you can have a requirements document, and if you've got your requirements integrated with your test cases and your defects, you can actually go ahead and see that if you've changed a requirement, you can actually see the corresponding test cases that are linked to it and go ahead and be able to look at the test case that's linked to it and to see whether or not that test case needs to change. So I'd like to summarize here as a result, and I'd like to say that first of all, there's a need to relate or to link your business requirements, once you have approved business requirements, to the product that you're actually delivering? Do I have some way of saying that the product I'm delivering actually is the product that the business requirements define? Traceability helps us provide the ability to define and maintain that relationship between the business artifacts and all of the downstream artifacts that we're creating during the software development process, to be able to define and maintain that relationship, especially as our requirements change. And the one thing I'd really like to stress is that traceability from requirements to those downstream artifacts, to the acceptance criteria, and the delivered product doesn't have to be done manually. And specifically, it doesn't have to be difficult or time-consuming. Automation, when you have all of your, when you're not using individual tools that have difficulty communicating with each other or that can't communicate with each other, when you instead you have an integrated tool set, it enables you to establish, maintain this traceability. Establishing that traceability is not necessarily that difficult. Maintaining it as your business requirements change over the course of the application development lifecycle can in fact be quite difficult, especially if you're doing it with a pencil and paper. Once again, have a very good eraser if you're doing it with pencil and paper. So automation with an integrated approach between requirements and those downstream artifacts is the best way of in fact accomplishing this. I'd like to thank you very much for attending. I enjoyed this.